Our humble pranams to the dignitaries on and off the dais. Welcome to Sri V. Narayan Memorial Lecture, organized by Shastra University every year at SRC in memory of late Sri V. Narayan of City Union Bank. To deliver the 11th lecture in the series, we have amidst us Dr. Bibek Debroy, economist and member NITI AAYOG. The session begins with an invocation. I call the choir upon the stage and request the audience to stand in devotional silence.
Bhajat akila hrujetri Atmavadeva parana vipashyata Atmavadeva parana vipashyata Yuddham yajata svardham yajata Yuddham yajata Bhajat akila hrujetrim Janani prithuvi kama durgashte Janani prithuvi kama durgashte Janako devah shakala dayalu Janako devah shakala dayalu Dhamya dadata dayatvam janata Dhamya dadata dayatvam janata Shreyo bhuya shakala janana Shreyo bhuya shakala janana Shreyo bhuya Shakala Jananam Shreyo Bhuyam Shakala Jananam Shreyo Bhuyam Shakala Jananam
May I take the privilege of inviting Dr. S. Vaidyasubramaniam, Dean Planning and Development Shastra, to welcome the guest and the gathering.
Distinguished speaker for the 11th Sri V. Narayan Memorial Lecture, my good friend Dr. Kamakodi, members of the board from the City Union Bank, executives from the bank, special invitees, faculty colleagues, and student friends. Well, good evening to all of you. This evening's gathering, as was recalled, is in the deserving honor and memory of one of the greatest banker sons of this Kumbakonam soil, who transformed the City Union Bank into one of the finest private banks in the country. And the transformation that he made in his period, which is also very important for many of us to learn as practicing bankers, as students who want to enter into the banking and financial services industry. That he was the bank's longest serving chairman was an asset to this bank, and the way in which he transformed this bank and the way in which the bank is continuing its operations today makes all of us wonder that how is that that this particular person in whose memory that we are having this lecture this evening was able to do all of this. And the simple lesson that all of us who had had the privilege of being very closely associated with him was that he transacted the business of banking with a human touch, which unfortunately is not found amongst many who are in this industry at this point of time. And it was that human touch which was very necessary for this part of the country especially, that transformed the lives of many households, that transformed the lives of many who are engaging in various agricultural pursuits, enhanced the rural prosperity of this part of the country, and also provided the much needed impetus and encouragement and support for small and medium business, small and medium enterprises. In short, he touched and made a big impact on the economic spine of our country. And that is why we felt, not only because we are beneficiaries of the City Union Bank, but also it was a responsibility on us to ensure that a man of this type needs to be celebrated every year. And that is why at Shastra University, we found it fit to organize a memorial lecture in his honor. And ladies and gentlemen, the hero of the day, whose unseen presence that the bank always sees, is Shivi Narayanan, in whose memory we are organizing this lecture every year. And for the benefit of the speaker, we are continuing the tradition of inviting some of the best to deliver the Narayanan Memorial Lecture. We have had Deputy Governors of Reserve Bank when Dr. Subir Gokhan and Mr. Gandhi address. We have also had Mr. Gopal Swamy as the Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Shankar as the Chief Vigilance Commissioner. We had had brilliant economists, Mr. S. Gurumurthy, Professor R. Vaidyanathan. We had had Mr. Montek Singh Ahluwalia as the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission. All of them visiting Kumbakonam to deliver the Narayanan Memorial Lecture. And continuing the same tradition, ladies and gentlemen, we have with us this evening a distinguished intellectual in his own rights, a man who I see as a manifestation of a very, very unique and multidimensional perspective of a practicing economist. An economist who brings into the picture an academic's perspective. He is not just a textbook economist. He is one who has understood the real functional economics, not only in our country, but from a global perspective as well. And he is also one integral part of various policy-making decisions that many governments have taken. And not only that, he also brings, I'm not sure whether you will witness shades of that brilliance in his lecture today, but for the benefit of the audience, you should also know that he has a different scholarly side to his intellect as well. A great Sanskrit scholar himself, he has done a number of works translating the Upanishads, Vedas, Mahabharata, Ramayana, and Bhagavad Gita. And that is why we consider it a great honor and privilege to have with us this evening Dr. Bibek Debroy, and I request all of you to put your hands together and welcome Dr. Bibek Debroy. Now, before I hand over the dais to Dr. Debroy, I thought I will just set the context for this evening's discussion, and I wouldn't take much time. From a timing perspective, the event today is so appropriate for a variety of reasons. One, that we are having a lecture on the union budget after 10 days, almost 12 days after the budget has been passed. Many of you would have seen the television. Many of you would have read various reports of the budget, analysis of the budgets in the next day's newspaper, where tons and tons of newsprint have been consumed. But all of those have been reactionary. And in my humble opinion, I'm afraid whether there was serious thinking that went into the budget analysis. And that is why I said this is so appropriate at this point of time, because between the time that the budget was delivered and the analysis that he is going to make today, there was enough time for people like him who has a penchant for numbers. I don't know how many of you watched him in action in the panel discussion in NDTV, where he said that everybody is talking without numbers and real numbers. And I'm sure Dr. Bibek Debroy would have done enough research, deep research on the budget to present an analysis of the budget. Another appropriate perspective from a timing sense is that many have also commented on this budget, that this budget is a critical budget, that this budget was the third budget of this government. And this government had this unique distinction of having a majority in the Lok Sabha, which none of the governments in the last three decades had. And so this third budget sandwiched between two time extremities. One, the last two budgets, it was just after they took over and they had the previous government's hangover and a lot of issues that need to be fixed. And moving further, the next two budgets, probably the symptoms of elections would start showing up. So this was by many viewed as a very critical budget. Did the finance minister really provide something very, very critical in terms of structural reforms or bold decisions, because this is the critical budget? Answers to that have been many different perspectives. Some have hailed the budget, some have condemned the budget. But one thing is that everybody thinks that the budget, which is the estimated revenue and expenditure of the government of India, should solve the problem of India itself. That the budget of the government of India should necessarily solve the problem of India itself, which is an unfair expectation from many of the stakeholders concerned. And at the cost of a repetition for a few here, I would usually recall this imaginary dialogue that, God has with three responsible heads of the states, and I take you back to the time frame of the early 1980s, when God interacts with the American president, the senior Reagan, then with General Zia-ul-Haq from Pakistan, and with Mrs. Gandhi. And God is engaging in a discussion with these three heads of the state. The first turn was Reagan's, and he asked God, when will our financial problem of America be resolved? God says, it will take 10 years. And Reagan starts crying. God says, why, what's the reason? I wouldn't be living to see the solution that could fix the financial problems of America. Then was the turn of Major General Zia-ul-Haq. He says, same question. When will our country's problem be fixed? God says it will take another 25 years, sir. Then Zia-ul-Haq starts crying for the same reason, that he would not be living to see all these problems getting fixed. Then Mrs. Gandhi asks the same question. You know what happened? God starts crying. You know, you have a big problem. I don't know whether this can be fixed at all. But the problem that we have is that we are assuming that the estimate of the revenue and expenditure of government of India should solve the problem of the country itself. And it is in this context that I want the speaker to also enlighten the audience to what it means to have a fair expectation of the union budget, so that everybody has a fair expectation. The reason is very simple, and this year's budget was grounded on those nine pillars that the finance minister so eloquently proposed. But at the end of the day, any government's exercise to present this budget has always been to satisfy the four important critical stakeholder elements, namely the public expenditure, the private investment, private consumption, as well as export. I am not sure whether the finance minister has adequately addressed all these four foundational pillars when he handled these nine pillars. Because in every budget, there will be somebody celebrating it and there will be somebody cursing the budget. And in my own opinion, on which I have written also an article last week, I found that this budget has a shades of a typical Indian family, that it had a father's aspiration, a mother's allocation, a distant relative like me, a distant relative's objection, and a family astrologer's prediction. So you had everything. You had an aspiration, which was seen from the way in which there was a reasonable substantive allocation to almost all sectors. There was responsible allocation to mainly the agriculture, and also address issues of rural prosperity. And also objections from different quarters, everybody complaining that it had nothing for the middle class and others having their own problems. And also the astrologer's prediction, which is very, very critical, because the finance minister has a lot of responsibility to ensure that this fiscal discipline that he wants to achieve is achievable by way of his revenue estimates and expenditure that he has in mind. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the background that I thought I will present for this evening's Union Budget Analysis by Dr. Bibek Debroy. And I'm extremely happy to welcome you, sir, on behalf of the Shastra University and the City Union Bank and the people of Kumbakonam. I also welcome all of you for what I think would be an enlightening lecture from Dr. Bibek Debroy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your brilliant introductory note and also the welcome address. Now it's time we honored our chief guest on behalf of Shastra, Professor K. G. Raghunathan, Dean Srinivasa Ramanujan Center, will now honor the chief guest with a memento. So on behalf of City Union Bank, may I invite Sri S. Balasubramanian, Chairman, to present a memento to our chief guest. Thank you, sir. Ignorance is a curse of God. Knowledge is the wing wherewith we fly to heaven. Union Budget Review 2016-17. The 11th Sri V. Narayan Memorial Lecture begins now. Sir, the stage is all yours.
Dr. Vaidya Subramaniam, Dr. Kamakodi, distinguished invitees, faculty members, and students. I had a reasonably good idea of the people who have stood before you here to deliver the Narayanan Memorial Lecture. And I feel honored, and I accept it with a great deal of humility. And Dr. Vaidya Subramaniam, thanks for your very, very kind words of introduction. It says I'm going to talk about the Union Budget. I will do nothing of the kind. I did not object to the title, because it was a nice, catchy title. And it had it said something else, many of you might not have turned up. So with the Union Budget being topical, it's a neat peg to hang whatever I have to say against the backdrop of the recent Union Budget. Why did I say I don't want to talk about the Union Budget? And don't get me completely wrong. The Union Budget is what? Constitutionally, the Union Budget is only an annual statement of the Union government's receipts and expenditure. That is all. Since 1991, since the reform started, Union Budget speeches have often been identified with, within quotes, big bang policy announcements. And when those big bang policy announcements are made in the course of the budget speech, everyone applauds, members of parliament applaud, the chambers of commerce and industry give the Union Budget marks of 9 out of 10. And after that, the big bang policy announcements are never implemented. So one should not judge any budget on the basis of the big bang policy announcements that are made. A budget to be realistic, a budget to be sensible, a budget to be pragmatic, has to focus on what it is supposed to do, namely concentrate on the union government's revenue and expenditure. The budget, after all, is only one day in a calendar of 365 days, or in this particular year, 366 days. Do you mean to say that on the remaining 364 days, the government ceases to exist? Of course not. So if you want to do those other changes, there is absolutely nothing on earth to prevent you from announcing and implementing those changes on other days of the calendar year. Of course, I will talk about the union budget. But before talking about the union budget, I want to offer to you the background against which the union government was formulated this particular year. And that background is important in terms of understanding what the union budget tried to do or tried not to do this financial year. As students, you will have often been told about governance. And I will begin by asking you what the word governance means, as opposed to the word government. Citizens throughout the world have elected governments. And in our particular case, there is a three-tier structure of government: the union government, the state governments, and the local bodies. So the question I will leave dangling for you, because it will be too much of a tangent, is what does the word governance mean? If governance is the same thing as government, then why use a distinct term? Of course, there are definitions of governance floating around. If you look at all of those definitions of governance, what it boils down to is the following. The difference between government and governance is governance conveys a notion of participation. Participation by citizens in the decision-making process, and that is what distinguishes governance from government. Having said this, as citizens, we have elected the government. What do we want the government to do? We want the government to deliver public goods and services. We can go around this hall and take a vote on what are the most important public goods and services. And all of us will have different kinds of views on what these public goods and services should be. But somewhere down the line, in the sense of prioritization, we will converge on this kind of list. Number one on that list will be law and order and security. Law and order and security, because that is why governments are elected throughout the globe in different countries of the world. The primary responsible of the government, however defined, is to deliver law and order and security. Number two on that list will be some things that are called physical infrastructure. The roads, the water, the electricity, because these are typically things where the private sector may or may not always deliver them. So there is a role for the government in delivering these, let us say in rural areas, in areas where there are what economists refer to as market failures. So the private sector will not necessarily come along and build rural roads. It will not necessarily come along and run a primary health center in a village. So that would be the second layer, some areas of physical infrastructure. And the third area would be some areas of social infrastructure where again there would be market failures. Examples are education, schools, literacy, skills, health. As citizens, we expect the government to do hundreds of different things. Some of us have been to the US. We've seen the way governments work in the United States or North America or Western Europe, and we expect the governments in India to deliver exactly the same kinds of goods and services. What is India's per capita income? India's per capita income today is around $1,700. What was the US per capita income not today, but in the 1870s? In the 1870s, not today, in today's dollars, the US per capita income was $3,000. So our per capita income today is $1,700. In the US in the 1870s, the per capita income was $3,000. What I'm flagging for you is India is still a poor country. India is still a relatively underdeveloped country, which means there is a paucity of financial resources, and more importantly, there is a lack of administrative capacity. So it is completely unreasonable to expect governments in India to deliver public goods and services on a scale delivered in North America or Western Europe. That does not mean the demand should not be there. However, expectations have to be realistic, and therefore there has to be a prioritization of resources. Who has the first call on those resources? We have 600,000 villages in India. I have not taught for a long time, but when I used to teach, textbooks that describe the Indian economy would say 70% of the population lives in rural India, suggesting living in villages is bad. 26% of the US population lives in rural United States. Have you heard anyone suggest that living in villages in the United States is bad? No, of course not. Why? Because villages in the US or villages in the developed world do not signify a lack of access to the judicial system, to the physical infrastructure, to the social infrastructure that I mentioned. Out of those 600,000 villages in India, 100,000 villages, more than 65 years after independence, still lack the kinds of items I have mentioned. So the priority for the government, the priority for any government, and the priority for this government is to ensure that the villages that do not have electricity, the villages that do not have primary health centers, the villages that do not have schools, those don't suffer from physical connectivity. Why is this important? This is important because of that extremely fashionable expression known as inclusive growth. And the question to ask is, what does inclusion mean? No one who's able-bodied, no one who's in the working age groups is voluntarily poor. People who are in the working age groups and are not disabled want to improve their lives. They don't want to be poor. What impedes them from improving their lives? What impedes them and constrains them from improving their lives is access to the judicial system, lack of skills, lack of education, lack of financial products, lack of roads, water and electricity. Those are the kinds of things that need to be delivered, not doles and handouts. I am not a politician, although I work for the government, so I can afford to say it explicitly. Most ministers of the government will not say it explicitly, but implicitly, one of the things that the government is trying to do, given that prioritization of resources, given that trade-off, is to switch expenditure from doles and handouts to delivery of these public goods and services, so that people are no longer deprived, poor, marginalized, and bypassed. With a priority on those 100,000 villages, with a priority on the Northeast, which has traditionally always suffered from lack of connectivity of all different kinds. With a priority also on the central and eastern parts of India, which have also tended to suffer from lack of connectivity. Second question to ask: who delivers these public goods and services? These public goods and services are not delivered by the government in Delhi. With the exception of law and order and security, all the other public goods and services are not delivered by the union government. They are not even delivered by state governments. They are delivered actually by local governments, the panchayats and the municipalities. One of the arguments that has always been made is India is excessively centralized. India was excessively centralized by the British during the colonial period, partly because of revenue considerations. Post-1947, India became even more centralized because of the system of planning and industrial licensing that was put into place. So one of the tasks is to decentralize and devolve. India has not only been centralized over a period of time, India has been much more centralized than China is today, and even more so than China was before the reforms in China started in 78-79. Before the reforms in China started in 78-79, even then, China was much more decentralized than India is. One of the biggest changes this government has brought about and is bringing about is decentralization. Indiscriminately, several of you probably use the expression center state. Center state suggests there is a center sitting there, and all the states represent the periphery. The rhetorical question I am asking you is, why do you use the expression center state? The word center is not there in the Constitution at all. The word that is used in the Constitution is union. So instead of using the word center state, we should begin to use the expression union state. The reason we continue to use the word center state is because we have a feeling that Delhi must somehow decide. Well, one of the major changes that has happened, and I will elaborate on this in a minute, is Delhi does not want to decide. And for some reason, people find this very strange. So all kinds of people come to me and say, and I'm just using one example, what is NITI Aayog planning to do on the smart cities? And I say, NITI Aayog does not want to do anything on the smart cities. It is for US citizens to figure out what a smart city means. That's the entire idea, or a large part of the idea behind the smart city concept. Sitting there in NITI Aayog, we do not want to tell the rest of the country what a smart city is. Bhubaneswar will interpret smart city in one way, Thanjavur will interpret it in another way, Pune will interpret it in a completely different way. So subject to that template, it is for the citizens to decide. But when I give this response, there is a complete lack of comprehension. And that is the reason I'm flagging before you this point, that one of the most important things this government has done is begin this process of decentralization, which turns the entire institutional mechanism, as we have understood it for more than 65 years, upside down. Let me begin with the Finance Commission. Constitutionally, the Finance Commission is the only organ meant to devolve funds to states. Constitutionally, that is the only organ. It is a different matter that the mandate of the Finance Commission was diluted in the mid-1970s, and an artificial distinction was drawn between planned and non-planned transfers, with non-planned devolution happening through the Finance Commission and planned transfers happening through the Planning Commission. Along comes the 14th Finance Commission. And what does the 14th Finance Commission do? It recommends an unprecedented increase in the share of the divisible pool for states from 32% to 42%. So down the years, it always used to be around 32%. And suddenly it goes up to 42%. Now realize what this means. States are free to decide what to do with that extra 10%. The center isn't going to tell them. The union government isn't going to tell them. Subject to whatever state level finance commissions say, it is up to the states to decide what they want to do with this. But people come and say, wait a minute, the union government has slashed expenditure on health. Constant commentary, slashed expenditure on health. There is a seventh schedule to the Constitution. The seventh schedule to the Constitution clearly sets out the union list, the state list, and the concurrent list. And what does this say? Where is health? Health is squarely in the state list. Except for the medical council, there is nothing at all indicating that health is anything to do with the union government. Of course, had it been the National Advisory Council, it would have sat down and devised a huge template on what should be done for health in India. The present government's position and NITI Aayog's position also is that yes, we agree that the infant mortality rate should be reduced, but what you do to reduce the infant mortality rate may be one thing in Tamil Nadu and may be a completely different thing in Bihar. What you want to do to reduce the infant mortality rate in one district of Bihar may be completely different from what you want to do in another district of Bihar. So why should we decide? All of you are aware of the fiscal compulsions that the finance minister faced, and I will revisit that in a minute. Given the fiscal pressures the Union Finance Ministry and the Finance Minister faced, it would have been very, very tempting to say, we will not implement the recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission as they stand. From 32% to 42%, we will not accept it. Or even if we accept it, we will stagger it. Initially, we will increase it from 32% and 37% to 37%, and subsequently, we will think about increasing it to 42%. That wasn't done. And as I said, it's now up to the states to decide what they should do with this. After all of this money goes, there is an additional amount of devolution that happens to the states. And that additional amount of devolution that happens to the states happens through things that were historically known as central sector schemes and centrally sponsored schemes. If you add all of it together, the total amount of money that goes to the states all along has been in the neighborhood of about 62%. It was 62% under earlier governments, it's 62% under the present government also. One difference being that a large chunk of that now is, as I just explained, untied, so states can decide whatever they want to do with it. Centrally sponsored schemes. How many centrally sponsored schemes were there? Not very long ago, 455. Did the block development officer, the BDO, even remember how many schemes there were? No. 455 schemes. The templates for those schemes were devised in Yojana Bhavan by the predecessor to the NITI Aayog, the Planning Commission. So let me give you one example, and this is only one example. There is a scheme known as the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sarak Yojana, which is the Prime Minister's scheme for building rural roads. And what does the PMGSY say? The PMGSY used to say, you will get central government money, union government money for building a rural road. But sometimes, in the middle of building that road, you need to build a bridge. Will you get money for building the bridge? No. So if you are a cash, relatively cash-rich state like Gujarat, you will use PMGSY to build the road and use your own scheme to build the bridge. If you are a relatively cash-starved state like Jharkhand, You will build the road. You won't have money to build the bridge. So you will have two bits of road dangling at either end. After this money was given, put in finance commission, question remains. What will be the nature and shape of these centrally sponsored schemes? As I just explained, there will be central sector schemes and centrally sponsored schemes over and above that 42%. It would have been very tempting for NITI Aayog to decide. And we would probably have allowed for the building of the bridges, but not for the roads. It would have been very tempting for Finance Ministry to decide. It would have been very tempting for the PM or the PMO to decide. Instead, what was done? Three subgroups of chief ministers were set up. Three subgroups of chief ministers were set up to recommend what should be done on the centrally sponsored schemes, what should be done on the skill development mission, and what should be done on Swachh Bharat. All chief ministers were members of one or the other of these groups. The one on centrally sponsored schemes was headed by Shivraj Singh Chauhan. The one on the Swachh Bharat mission was headed by Chandrababu Naidu. The one on skill development was headed by Prakash Singh Badal. They submitted the reports in October 2015. And those recommendations have been accepted. So just before this budget, several of you are aware that the Swachh Bharat cess was increased by 0.5%. And several of you blamed the government and blamed the finance ministry. What is this? Another cess. We are sick and tired of paying taxes, and along comes this government and slaps another 0.5% Swachh Bharat cess. What you may or may not be aware of, and in all probability you are not aware of this, is that the subgroup of chief ministers set up by Chandrababu Naidu recommended a 2% cess. So having, you don't believe my words, read the report. It's up there in the public domain on our website, amongst others, the NITI Aayog website. Having set up a subgroup of chief ministers, having got their report, which says impose a 2% Swachh Bharat cess, it is a strange kind of paternalism to suggest that we're not going to implement it. But I will come back to this also later. The next item I want to flag for you is, despite all the reforms and whatever, whatever, there will always be people who are below the poverty line, however defined, and they will always be beneficiaries of subsidies. They deserve those subsidies. On the subsidy figure, a quick number. What is the total amount that union and state governments together collect as taxes? Not just union, but union and state governments taken together, how much do they collect as taxes? 17% of GDP. So remember that figure, 17% of GDP. In some other years, it may be 18% of GDP. There is an organization known as the NIPFP. The NIPFP computed some years ago all subsidies. When I say all subsidies, subsidies aren't only subsidies that come out of the budget and therefore are explicit subsidies, they can be implicit subsidies also. Subsidies aren't only subsidies for consumption. There are subsidies for production also. Subsidies aren't only the union government ones of petroleum products, fertilizer and food. If you add up all the subsidies, production, consumption, explicit, implicit, NIPFP studies said 14% of GDP. 17% being collected as taxes, 14% on subsidies. In the first year of studying economics or teaching economics, we are taught economics means the allocation of resources amongst competing users. So there are opportunity costs. After having taught and studied for the rest of our lives, we forget about opportunity costs, certainly if it concerns the government. If it concerns my managing my budget, I know about opportunity costs all the time. I order a pizza today, I can't watch a movie. But no, for the government, the presumption is it has an infinite quantity of resources. That money that is being spent on subsidies means that money cannot be spent on the roads, the water and the electricity and the schools and whatever, whatever. So the response to the middle class, to the so-called middle class whom you see on television, who are not at all representative of the poor of the country, yes, they articulate, yes, they have very high decibel levels, yes, you see them on television all the time, particularly if it happens to be English language television, which is interpreted as national television, which really means the television that is watched between Noida on one side and Gurgaon on the other. What is there for them in the budget? What is there for them in the budget is the better infrastructure. That's what you should look for in the budget. Not what exemptions I'm going to get and whether my tax rate has come down and whether my threshold level has gone up. That's beside the point. To give you another figure, the total amount of money that the union government loses in the form of exemptions is 5.5% of GDP. Depending on the year, it's between 5 to 5.5% of GDP. That's revenue that could have been used by the union government, could have been used by the state government. But I digressed. How do you know who's below the poverty line? Traditionally, what used to be done, was to use something known as the National Sample Survey, the NSS. And on the basis of that, you compute what percentage of Tamil Nadu's population is below the poverty line. Doesn't solve the problem. Because as the expression suggests, NSS is a survey, it is not a census. A survey will never allow me to determine whether my individual household is poor or not. That can only be done through a census and decentralized identification, where you list out the assets that a household has, put it up on the wall of the panchayat, so that people whose names have not been included can come and complain, and put it up for public scrutiny, so that if my name has wrongly been included, you can come and object. There is always a precedence addressed to Parliament. It's in the name of the president. But obviously that speech is drafted by the incumbent government. Go back and read the president's address to Parliament in June 2004. Not now, June 2004. Go and read paragraph 38. Paragraph 38 in June 2004 was a listing of all the various things the UPA 1 government had promised to do in the first 100 years. First 100 days. Thank God we don't have it for 100 years. In that list of items for the first 100 days was decentralized identification. Was it ever implemented? No. But now for rural India, we have that database. The SECC database. It's called the SECC database. It's not yet been finalized on the urban side, but it's up there. So the first time we have an integration of three different databases coming together. SECC, the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts. A lot of questions were raised about the quality of the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts. And that's a legitimate question, because several of them were, should I say this? Yes, I should say this. Several of them were implemented by public sector banks through their BCs without necessarily doing all the checks. But after the checking, at least 50%, I'm not saying 50%, at least 50% of these accounts are new and clean accounts. So in some sense, for years and years, we debated about financial inclusion. The financial inclusion debate has now changed a little bit, because we are not debating about people opening bank accounts. What we are now debating is, how do we persuade people to use those bank accounts? How do we have the necessary financial products? Amongst the products that the government has been trying to push are pension, medical insurance, health insurance, and direct transfers of subsidies, particularly for petroleum products. Fertilizers is a different issue, and food gets into legislation that was passed by Parliament. So you can't tinker with the food part of it unless you change the legislation. So there are these three databases that are coming together, which will completely revolutionize the nature of public expenditure to the extent it concerns subsidies. Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts, SECC, and the Aadhaar database. Because again, half of the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts have already been seeded with the Aadhaar database. Having said all this, you have probably formed the impression I have not said anything about the Union Budget at all, which is what I was supposed to speak about. But this background is important to understand what the Union government is trying to do through its budget. One point I should have mentioned is the entire controversy about GDP growth rates, about the new series vis-a-vis the old series. I will not get into that debate unless it figures in the course of the course question and answer, except to point out, using the new series, not using the old series, but using the new series, GDP growth from 2013 to 2014 was 6.7%. Using the new series, it was 6.7%. What is it now? It's 7.5%. So factually, there is no denying that from 6.7, it has gone up to 7.5%, an increase of 0.8 percentage points. You can legitimately argue that the increase should have been much more, which is a valid argument. But to argue there has been no increase, just as to argue there has been no reduction in inflation, these are completely unwarranted remarks. At the beginning of this fiscal year, there were four or five issues that confronted the government. All of those four or five are pertinent so far as formulating the budget of this year is concerned. One, what do we do about public investments? How can we ensure that public investments recover? How can we ensure that private investments recover? Public investments have begun to recover, especially in roads and now even in railways. On private investments, I have the following to say. Firstly, with public investments recovering, private investments should recover with a lag of two or three quarters, remembering, of course, that in several sectors, there is still excess capacity. And also remembering that increasingly the evidence suggests that public investments are not being driven by bank borrowing, but are being driven by other sources. The second issue that confronted the government at the beginning of the year is what do we do about the non-performing assets of banks? The distressed assets. To me, this is more of a symptom and less of a disease. Why am I saying this? I think the essential problem is that most infrastructure projects involve lending for 20 years, 25 years, even more. Once upon a time, we used to have the DFIs. In the course of the reforms, we thought that the distinction between the DFIs and the banks was a blurred one, and the DFIs effectively disappeared. Banks are singularly ill-equipped to lend for 20 years and 25 years. And most of infrastructure investments are financed via the debt route and not via the equity route. And obviously, the cost of private funds tend to be higher than the cost of private funds. So whenever the business cycle goes into a downswing, the revenue projections go haywire. The PPP gets a bad name, and you have stressed assets. So one of the questions before the finance minister was, what do I do about this? Fiscally, I am not in a position, even if it were to be desirable, to pump in capital infusion. Not that that would solve the problem. A lot of people would have said, and do say, divest equity in the public sector banks. Assume you can do that. Do you think Shastra, I mean just using Shastra as a name, do you think Shastra would buy equity in any of the distressed public sector banks? It would be cheaper for Shastra to get to set up a new bank. So it's not a simple solution. The third issue that confronted the government was, what do I do about agriculture and the rural sector, which had been in some distress? It's not quite the case that this government has suddenly, within quotes, turned populist. It's more a recognition of the fact that the agriculture and the rural sector is in some distress. A little bit of it because, and I should have said this earlier, because of what I said about the 14th Finance Commission, because of what I said about the reports of the subgroups of chief ministers, which only came into place, only submitted in October 2015, the year 15-16 was a slightly distorted year. So it is indeed the case that funds transfer was affected. It is indeed the case that funds flow under MGNRE, ESN, PMGSY, and a plethora of other schemes was affected. All of this should begin to settle down from 16-17. Finance Minister and the budget. The first question, the really important question was, to what extent should the fiscal consolidation happen? It was the fiscal deficit to GDP ratio was 3.9%. Should it stay at 3.9%? Should it be brought down to 3.7%? Should it be brought down to 3.5%? Of course, it's a separate point that the fiscal deficit is not really the issue. The real issue is the nature of government expenditure, primarily revenue expenditure, particularly with the pay commission and with OROP. So the call that was taken, more as a signal rather than anything else, was to reduce the deficit to 3.5%. The question to ask is, and I think you mentioned it in your introductory remarks, can we believe the government that is going to reduce it to 3.5%? On that, I have two comments to make. The first comment is, did this government succeed in adhering to its promise in 15-16? Of course it did. So if it succeeded in adhering to its promise in 15-16, why should we not presume and give it the benefit of doubt and presume that it will stick to its promise in 16-17 also? On purely GDP growth, this budget, and remember, one of the remarkable things that's happening in India now is that there's very little difference between the nominal rate of GDP growth and the real rate of GDP growth. The two are virtually identical. The nominal rate of GDP growth projected in this budget is 11%, which is reasonable enough. If you have a 7.5% real rate of growth, the 11% nominal rate of GDP growth is not that unrealistic. And the revenue growth that is projected, and revenue is much more of a function of nominal GDP growth rate, is 11.3%, which is not unreasonable either. What can perhaps be questioned is the obtaining of revenue under the non-tax revenue head, which includes disinvestments, which have had a fairly bad track record. So let me defend NITI Aayog and say that NITI Aayog has now been entrusted with the job of identifying PSUs for disinvestment, and there's no particular reason why we should be terrible about that. Last two or three words and then I will stop. On the tax side, there are two issues. One was the direct tax side. The direct tax side, the phasing out of exemptions which I mentioned on the corporate tax side have been almost pre-announced. The primary reason why it was not done this year, although it had been pre-announced, it's only been done for new entrants and that too to 29%, is because one thought that let the economy recover a bit and then we go ahead with that. On the direct tax side, the main improvement other than that has been in tax administration, where I can give countless instances where procedures have improved. On the GST side, let me only say this much. What is important? Is it important to have a good GST, or is it important to have a GST in a hurry? I would say it's important to have a good GST rather than have a GST in a hurry. If one had the GST in a hurry, and I can save the details for the Q&A, one would have amounted to having a bad GST. I hope I've been able to give you a flavor, not just of the budget, but about various things that went into the formulation of the budget. Thank you very much.
We have reserved 15 to 20 minutes for an interactive Q&A. So I think we'll have time to take at least 5 questions, and then we'll decide whether we can take further. So if there is a question, please raise your hand and we'll have the microphone passed. And by the time the microphone reaches the first questioner there, shall I, with your permission, start, ask the first question, or I'll reserve mine for the last? Fine, you can start. Please, yeah.
Sir, thank you so much. You have paraded the Sabka vision of Prime Minister and how the NITI Aayog and Government of India is working towards realizing the vision of Sabka vision, Sabka Vikas. Being an economics professor, I'm a little bit worried about, you mentioned about poor. Having a reader of Thomas Piketty's Capital and then Inequality, What to be Done by James Atkinson, and then Great Divide by Joseph Stiglitz. I'm a bit worried that sophisticated economic system in the world, US itself, is now exposed due to its rampant inequality. What measures honestly taken by Government of India and your NITI Aayog, please enlighten us to eradicate inequality, and my fear is that India is heading towards crony capitalism. Please, sir. And one more question. In 2004, you have released your book, Redeeming Economic Pledge. In the preface, you Redeeming Economic Pledge in 2004, in the preface, you highlighted that, highlighted an argument which was very popular then, that in economic reform in India, not marketed properly at the grassroots level. That's why economic reform is not able to be picked up, and it is not committedly realized in India. First question about inequality. Second is about
better marketing of economic reforms.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I sort of dislike questions that would amount to my writing a dissertation. On inequality, since you have asked a question on inequality, let me ask you a counter question which I don't expect you to answer, which is, where is all the empirical data in Piketty's book from? All the empirical data in Piketty's book is based on the US and Western Europe. So therefore, the question on the basis of Piketty's book is best answered by people who are formulating policies in the US and in Western Europe. On so far as inequality is concerned, I already told you my take on inclusion, which is my interpretation of inequality. Just for the record, and I'm answering this with a great deal of reluctance, there is a measure of inequality used by economists called the Gini coefficient. The higher the Gini coefficient, the more unequal society is. The lower the Gini coefficient, the more equal society is. Some of you may or may not be aware that in India we do not have data on income distributions. We really have good data on consumption distributions, and the Gini coefficient on consumption distributions will always be lower than the Gini coefficient on income distributions. Having said that, the Gini coefficient for consumption distributions in India is around 0.34. For income distributions, and some data exist, it is around 0.4. Do I think these are alarming? No, they are not. Piketty has suggested in an interview that the Gini coefficient in India is 0.6. I challenge anyone to prove to me that the Gini coefficient in India is 0.6. Can I finish the answer? Now, so far as crony capitalism, again, I don't understand what that means. There is not only crony capitalism, there is plenty of crony socialism also. To me, in both forms, it involves a bending of rules for private benefit. I already mentioned the production subsidies, which are one instance of that.
In addition, what I did not have the time to say is the best antidote to many forms of corruption is to make rules transparent. Make in India does not happen in Delhi, make in India happens in the states. Similarly, imparting transparency does not happen in Delhi, it happens in the states. To the extent the union government is concerned, I can give countless instances where an attempt has been made to make things transparent. So far as marketing of reforms is concerned, it depends on the definition of reforms. Because of course there is a political economy. If you cannot persuade members of parliament that a reform is necessary, then you may as well forget about persuading the country that the reform is necessary. If you are sure about reform, however how it may be defined, you should be able to persuade. Yeah, sorry, you had a follow-up. There are plenty of students here. Fine. You are an economics teacher. Okay, I presume several of your students are here. Okay, doesn't matter. Other students are here. So I will pose this question to you as an economics teacher. And I will pose this question to students also. One definition of inequity is to say, or one definition of equity is to say, that every student should have an equal chance of getting admission into Shastra University, which is my definition of equity. A completely different definition of equity is to say that every student, when he or she passes out from Shastra, should get exactly the same mark. That is really the Piketty definition of equity, which I do not accept. Because that is what it amounts to.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So we will make sure the questions are a little diversified from an audience standpoint. We'll have a question from the bankers, then from the students as well. So let's make sure that everybody gets an opportunity.
Yes, sir. So you have picturized that total India, what is the status? There is a, as an Indian, there is a shake. Why, as a politician, they are not planning for it? And there is a lot of smart city they are planning, and they are doing giving a lot of investment on that. In what way it will help the rural development?
Well, first let me begin by a statement that I should have probably made earlier. That the union government, as with other governments, is starved for resources. So therefore, what you need to do and what you are trying to do is to leverage the funds that you have got so that the investments can happen through leveraging of those funds, not directly financing all of it yourself. On the villages, I already mentioned the focus on providing roads, water, electricity, etc. to the villages. And it may surprise you to know that the Prime Minister tracks these things on an almost monthly basis. And the number of villages that do not have electricity, I'm just using that as an example, has now dropped to 10,000. I'm talking about villages. Don't give me the obvious criticism that is the village getting electrified, not every household getting electrified. Well, that's true, but even the fact that villages are getting electrified is quite significant. Now, the smart cities, the reason I mentioned the smart cities is that the smart cities incorporate an element of what I began with, which is the distinction between governance and government. Because citizens are now deciding what smart cities should be. And smart cities should not be looked at in isolation, because they should be taken in conjunction with the Amrut mission, which is for habitations that are a bit smaller. So the overall intention is that for the rural sector, I provide the infrastructure, I ensure the insurance, I ensure what is the beginnings of a social safety net. But I also recognize that urbanization is correlated with economic development. So I need to encourage urbanization, ensure that it happens in a more managed kind of way, instead of discouraging it and instead of pretending that I will make sure people stay in rural India by using things like the MGNR. So that's the change in philosophy.
Yeah. The next question. Who's there?
Sir, when money is allocated, say, towards the construction of roads, tenders are issued, and sometimes the state governments have to cooperate in, you know, executing those. So state governments have to cooperate towards, you know, finishing the projects and ensuring that the projects are completed. But then sometimes the state governments pull the plug on those projects. So is any wastage, sir, while the budget is being planned, while the budget is being made?
So how do you make the expenditure more accountable and responsible?
Yes. Yep.
Now look, this is a question that is, you see, firstly, as NITI Aayog, part of our job is to monitor improvements in indicators. But that's not the philosophical response to your question. At some point in your life, you expected, or even if you did not expect, your parents decided things for you. Sooner or later, you become an adult, and the parents cease to decide. I think the philosophical response to your question, not the monitoring, as I said, that monitoring as NITI Aayog will do, the philosophical response to your question is, why should I presume that state governments are irresponsible? That's a strange kind of paternalistic view to take. State governments are just as responsible as the union government is. And if state governments are irresponsible and fritter away their resources, it is not the job of PMO or North Block or NITI Aayog to hold a danda over their heads. It is the job of the citizens to vote out bad governance. So let us presume that state governments are responsible. Let us presume that the urban local bodies and the panchayats are also responsible. Let us abide by the spirit of the constitution. And in the spirit of the constitution, we have this decentralization, not only in the terms that I mentioned, but also decentralized planning, which means going up from the district level up.
Anybody from the bank here, the first?
How to rectify that? How to? Drafting lagma. That is command, so many things. It will lead to a lot of future litigation.
No, are you saying drafting in general within government or in parliament?
In the bill. In the finance bill itself.
Let me put it like this, that there is a general lack of drafting experience, as I'm sure you are aware, within all of government. And certainly so far as the legal aspect of it is concerned. I'm not just talking about this budget, I'm making a general problem. A general point. One of the problems is, because of reasons of confidentiality, something like the finance bill cannot always be shown to people who are legal experts. And North Bloc traditionally has had no particular reason to have someone with a strong legal oblique drafting background, which is what is required. So I recognize the problem. It's not very easy to solve the problem, but the best response is really that the finance bill is not being passed as it is presented, but will be passed only after the debate. Sorry? Whom to report, meaning? No, but this is something that I'm very surprised about. This is something I'm very surprised about because there is a site called mygov.in which is sort of flooded. Of course, in terms of what you see through mygov.in, there is a sort of generational angle to that. But mygov.in, immediately it reaches. But just on that finance thing, one of the other reactions I have is the way it is headed. Soon the budget will become a completely transparent exercise. So all this hype over the budget will completely cease because the budget will become completely predictable. And indeed, while on the hype, one of the points I wanted to make but forgot is that the attention should increasingly now shift from the union budget to the state government budgets because half the capital investments are being made by state governments now.
We'll have time for two more questions. Okay, the one here, Dr. Badri, and then I'll ask the last question. Okay, quick.
SBI alone as of March 2015 has around 56,000 bad loans, dues to be paid. And with programs like Startup India coming on, what would be the face of banks, sir? Already they have lot of amount in deficit, in dues. And with projects like Startup India coming on, people will be going.
Will Startup India be bank friendly?
Not exactly that, sir.
Banks have the capacity.
I'm glad you asked that question about Startup India because look, Startup India is not only about IT and the financial sector. In fact, Startup India reflects an attempt to get investment and entrepreneurship going not only in corporate India but outside corporate India also. That's the essential idea behind Startup India, and it's not IT or financial products alone. Now, the question that you've asked is a very valid question. But as I said, or as I sort of hinted at, this is not a very easy question to answer. It's not a simple issue of pumping in money that won't solve the problem. It's not a very simple issue of disinvesting equity in public sector banks. It's not that simple either. The only thing that has happened, which should ease somewhat, is the legal issues connected with a PPP project going wrong, the dispute provisions. Those are being eased. So I don't know a satisfactory answer to your question. Probably there isn't.
Yep.
Well, one of the things that's going to happen is sooner or later, probably later rather than sooner, there's going to be a shakeout in banks.
Yes, this.
So, there is a confusion in GDP growth statistics. What is your opinion about future GDP aspects?
What is the future? Define the future.
Time horizon.
Are you asking about 20, 30, 40?
In the near future?
No. Define the near. For God's sake, put a year to it.
Quantify it. This government's tenure or a decade?
In the next financial year?
You see, look, today the way this financial year, the chief economic advisor, who's a friend, says it's going to be 7.5. Despite he being a friend, I would say I think it's going to be closer to 8. So what's happening is every year it's increasing with the new GDP series by about 0.5% or so. And so you multiply by the number of years. But given the several structural changes that are being brought about, I think there will be a structural kind of break after about 2 years. So instead of increasing at 0.5%, you'll see a sudden increase by about 1% or thereabouts.
Okay. So, okay.
You are emphasizing on decentralization. What about the planning process? The planning commission has been replaced with 8% at the grassroots level, at the local body level. It's supposed to go up. We are talking about participatory planning. Are we ever going to see that in the distant future, at least in 20 years?
You don't actually have to wait 20 years. The planning commission never collected data on districts. It collected data on states. District level data have several problems. There are time lags, data quality issues. You can visit our website and you will find that we have collected district level data and put it up on our website, not just for our consumption, but for everyone's consumption. You can also access that. The Prime Minister wants us to do it village level upwards. We have said village level data are very bad. We can't do that. So we'll do this monitoring district level upwards. In some cases, we are doing it block level. You will say, okay, but that is data. What about the planning part of it? I'm sure you will be surprised to know that every village in Madhya Pradesh now has a village level plan. So the Madhya Pradesh plan is being built upwards. We have started district level planning exercises in Sikkim and also in Rajasthan. Better way of answering your question is there are several states. All states are not very similar. In several of those states, things, and it's not binary 0-1. Several of those states, actually, the process has begun. Some others, of course, it has.
Okay. Dr. Badri? Yep.
Two questions, sir. One is about recovering the outstanding loan. When a layman is not able to pay 1 lakh rupees, he's thrash. When another person walks away with 9,000 crore with the public sector money, how you want it to be treated? Second one, yes, the primary education is very important. As per the constitution, we need to give it. And what about the higher education, government support for higher education sector, so that we are talking about none of the Indian universities are in the top 100 of the world. But the government is withdrawing its support from higher education. What is your take on these two things?
Well, this is the Vijay Mallya kind of question. And I'm always misunderstood when I give my answer. Particularly because you work a lot with the MSME, I'm going off on a tangent. One of the problems with MSME enterprises, which will change a little bit when the bankruptcy law is passed, is that the assets and liabilities of the entrepreneur are not separated out from the assets and liabilities of the enterprise. The limited liability concept doesn't really exist for the MSME. Unfortunately, limited liability has a lot of desirable elements also. So what we see in the case of Mr. Vijay Mallya is limited liability in action, where the individual's assets and liabilities are distinct from the enterprise's assets and liabilities. And beyond that, there is a point, which is that what was the bank doing? And that gets into issues of the kind of things that were accepted as collateral and whatever. But the point I'm making is you can't have it both ways. Not you, generally. You can't simultaneously say that the government should treat public sector banks as independent and simultaneously say you want the government to interfere when something has gone wrong. Now, so far as higher education is concerned, there is a higher education reform as a terminal goal, which involves setting up a regulator, etc., etc. As part of that terminal goal, what is contemplated is, I do not finance institutions. I finance individuals who warrant scholarships. why should my money go to a particular institution of higher education? I said a terminal goal. It will take a long time to get there, because if one of the things that so-called middle class is agitated about, it is higher education,
yeah,
apart from tax breaks. So it will take a long while, irrespective of the nature of the government, of the political composition of the government, to get there. But so far as this government is concerned, there's complete clarity about the terminal that I fund through scholarships. I do not fund delivery.
Yeah. So I will conclude this with one last question. Yeah, so that's my last question. See, you started off very rightly saying that it's becoming a meaningless exercise to analyze the budget after 1991-92, and that's why even the great legendary Nani Palkiwala himself stopped delivering his budget lectures after 91-92. Now, having said that, now in that case, and you also touched on certain philosophical issues in your Q&A, so I will also give a philosophical touch to the last question. Now, when can the budget become more democratic in terms of its creation itself? See, it's so much of secrecy, you know, this Alwa exercise begins and nobody knows what's happening there. How are we as citizens, you talked about governance, and how are we as citizens, how will we know that our voice is heard in the budget process? We send a lot of emails, letters to the TRU, but we don't have this feeling that, you know, our voice was heard in the budget exercise. So when is this budget going to be a democratic exercise? And secondly, you also, your concern was on the revenue side, and NITI Aayog being identified to handle these potential assets for disinvestment. LIC, you know, good or bad, they are the potential candidate to purchase these assets. Now, when will this purchase be democratized? Do we have more LICs who can purchase this? What is NITI Aayog's idea on that, whether disinvestment can be more democratic than being just with a few of them who have the capacity to purchase but not necessarily the intent?
Actually, that's quite a bundle of questions. You see, firstly, I will again mention this mygov.in. Mygov.in is taken quite seriously. You might not get a response, but everything that comes on mygov.in is actually read. And let me sort of disclose a secret that is not really anything confidential. The name NITI Aayog came through mygov.in. It was one of the two suggestions that came through mygov.in. One suggestion that came through mygov.in was NITI, as in English, National Institution for Transforming India. The other suggestion that came through mygov.in was NITI, as in Hindi NITI, NITI Aayog. NITI as in policy. Now, both were sufficiently attractive. Instead of dispensing or discarding either of those, both were clubbed together. So if I write it in English, then NITI Aayog is nonsense, because Aayog is already there in institution. So if I send you a letter in English, it will say only NITI. If I write to you in Hindi, it will say NITI Aayog, which is of course too subtle a distinction for most people. But in any case, mygov.in is taken very seriously.
So that's the best vehicle.
Any suggestion on mygov.in is... And actually, you will be surprised, but this varies from ministry to ministry. Some ministries, social media has also taken pretty seriously, not all ministries. But there is an underlying, a second strand in your question, which is, when will the budget become irrelevant? And if you notice, well, we had not one budget, we had two budgets. And for all practical purposes, the other budget has been rendered irrelevant, because everything that was happening in the railway budget was known. So not much attention focused on the railway budget. So it's become already transparent, and it's just a matter of time before the railway budget completely vanishes. So far as the union budget is concerned, one issue is the moment, I said this earlier, when you have tax stability and everything is standardized, then per se the budget will become irrelevant so far as the tax rates are concerned. It will also largely become irrelevant from the expenditure side, because expenditure is also now a state subject, or it's completely transparent what the centrally sponsored schemes are going to be. Probably implicit in what you said was a question of, will we ever have a US-like system where the budget is debated prior to the budget?
Precisely.
Constitutionally, that's very difficult to do. It would require an amendment in the Constitution. But if you have all of this transparency somewhere down the line, that becomes probably a non-issue.
Okay. And democratic purchase?
You see, look, what NITI is going to recommend is not yet clear.
Yeah.
It's not that I'm privy to something that I'm not disclosing. That might also have happened, but as it is, it's too early, so I don't even know what we are thinking of as NITI. But the issue really is that if I divest and do not privatize, I will never get the right value. But if I actually privatize, I will never be able to do it completely transparently. It can never be transparent because I can't sort of float tenders. And there will be always some element of non-transparency in the valuation of land. And in our preliminary discussions already, we are facing some problems about how do you value land subjectively, not subjectively, objectively. Okay. So the broader thing, yes, I agree with what you're saying, but I'm not very sure what the government would plan to do or what we even as NITI would recommend.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Gratitude is a currency that we can mint for ourselves and spend without fear of bankruptcy. May I call upon Dr. N. Kamakodi, CEO and Managing Director, City Union Bank, to propose a vote of thanks.
Dr. Bibek Debroy, Dr. Vaidhi Subramaniam, friends. On behalf of Chairman, Board Members, CUBNs, and on my personal behalf and behalf of my family members, let me express my hearty thanks to Vice Chancellor, Shastra University, Dean Dr. Vaidhi Subramaniam, Dean Ramanujam Center, faculty members, students, invitees, and everyone assembled here for this 11th Narayanan Memorial Lecture. And we really feel, Shastra being the part of conducting this annual lecture, this lecture series has become an important event in the annual calendar of this part of the world. So I once again thank all of you for making it happen, and our special thanks are due to Dr. Debroy, particularly making this immediately after the budget period to share the how the planning process is done and what are all the changing phase of governance that is happening in the after the new government has taken over. And probably looks like sitting far from Delhi, it gives us sufficient confidence that probably we'll be seeing a new India sooner, and think that change process has actually started, and it is giving us a lot of confidence. And particularly when he heard mygov.in, the government listens to all suggestions from the various stakeholders of the country, and also even that process will start right from the village panchayat level. I think when the implementation really gets into phase, maybe sooner or later, I think definitely we should be seeing a much better country. So thank you, sir, and particularly, I mean, for being part of that entire transformation process. Once again, thank you very much for that, sir. So our thanks are for media who gathered in, I could see many from the media fraternity for to give extra coverage, particularly on magazines tomorrow. And once again, let me thank all of you for attending this in memory of Shri Narayanan. And once again, our hearty thanks to all of you. Thank you.
Please join the choir for national anthem.
Jana Mana Adinayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidada Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Banga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jalatita Ranga तब शुभ नामे जाहे तब शुभ आशीष माहे गाहे तब जय गाता जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विदाता